And welcome to the wildest movie of the year in Big Trouble in Little China, Kim Cattrall. Well, you fly, you get thrown around, you're hauled on ropes, you dive, you swim. What am I leaving out? What else were you called upon to do that maybe just, hey, you had no warning?
Well, I didn't get to explode. Somebody else did. Almost. I felt like I was going to explode at times.
And the irony is, we were just talking about this. You portray a woman with green eyes.
Yes.
But you still had to...
wear contact lenses.
What happened? Am I in the shot? Yeah. Excuse me. Yeah. Well, that's all right.
I'm sorry.
I've got the opening there anyway, so that's okay.
I just need you to lean back.
Sure. That's a bad habit I have. Could I ask you that again?
Sure.
Just try that one again. Okay. Yeah. It's crucial to the plot that you play a woman with green eyes, but in the finest Hollywood tradition...
they were green, but not green enough.
Well, that's got to be some kind of a humble pie to have to eat there, huh?
Well, yes. Well, it was pretty difficult. They were very large contact lenses, and we had a contact lens technician on the set at all times to put them in and then take them out and put them in and take them out and put them in and take them out all day.
You hear a lot about hijinks on the set of a dramatic picture to kind of keep things loose. But when a picture like this is wild from the very beginning, how do you relax on a set that's chaos already?
Like this. Just like that. You go into your dressing room and you close the door and you say, call me when you need me because I'm going to take 5 minutes without the contact lenses. And you try and get into some kind of comfortable robe or something because in 5 minutes you're going to be sprayed down from head to foot by a hose because you're supposed to be wet because you just got out of this. It was amazing.
Shooting at a pretty fast clip too?
Oh yes, John shoots real fast.
Yeah.
He knows what he wants, he gets it. That's it, on to the next.
It must be very interesting on a set like that to wonder who you end up getting close to. If not with your fellow actors, maybe some of the technicians. Who did you come to rely upon? Who did you spend the most time with while you were shooting?
Well, I had most of my scenes with Kurt, and I sort of gravitated towards him. We have sort of a common interest in, well, sort of recently in motorbikes and Harley Davidson, so lots to talk about.
Is that where he got his hat?
Yes, he has a Harley Davidson. He's a real Harley Davidson kind of guy.
So that was his own thing?
Yeah, I think so.
Did he put one on your head, too?
Well, I was going to wear a t-shirt, but I thought that was a little much today. You know, I wanted to dress up. Also, Kurt and I, we're much different. Our backgrounds are much different, but we've been around the business for a long time, both of us, in me in theater and he in film, in TV and movies and stuff. So we were like almost the older kids on the block. There was a lot of younger people in the movie.
And the strangeness of this situation must serve to either bring you closer or split you apart.
Uh-huh.
It's nice to hear.
Yeah, it brought us closer. It really did. Mm-hmm. It was a nice crew, too, which I think makes a big difference because John works with the same people a lot on his crew.
You were hoisted up on wires on a number of occasions. Is that kind of scary?
Yes.
I mean, how about terrifying?
Yeah, it's pretty scary. Yeah.
Yeah. Now, were all of these a part of the job description initially?
Well, you know, you read it one way, and then you get to the set, and it looks a different way, you know. But we had very good stunt people, so if it got real hairy, she would do it. My stunt double would do it. Debbie would do it. I was never really in any danger. It was just sometimes it was a little uncomfortable to sit for 4 hours with like wet blue jeans and a wet t-shirt and a wet sort of mohair jacket.
You know, what do you talk about? You know, what do you do to pass the time in a situation like that?
Nothing. You get out of those wet clothes and then you put dry ones on and then they wet you down again.
In a film that has such a foreign and exotic flavor, you yourself bring to it a background that seems to blend a lot of countries. Could we run that down, for example? Okay, you're in a film about China.
In China, yes.
But
I live in Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
I'm married to someone who lives in Germany, who was born in Poland. I was born in England and grew up in Canada. That's about it. It's not really that much.
Did it equip you, however, to be an actress, to have a lot of traveling, a lot of different mix of
backgrounds? I think so. I think it really does because, you know, actors have always been considered gypsies. You know, they roam around a lot. I roam around a lot. Not in a covered wagon, usually on a Lufthansa going somewhere or other. But I enjoyed traveling. I used to hate spending time in a hotel room, but I enjoy it now because I think the roles that I'm playing, I'm enjoying more. They're much more appetizing. Mm-hmm. There's much more to grab onto.
Let's talk about your films now. Things like Porky and Turk 182, Porky's and Now This. Wow, they seem to be decidedly different. Maybe a bit on the madcap side, but what about those experiences now? What do you feel like they've equipped you to do best?
I think think that each movie...
Like on your feet?
Yes, it does. It really does. I think the wonderful thing about Kami is that it opens up on the set, especially, because you do it in film, you do it for the first time, you know, right there, you meet your leading man, or luckily, you know, sometimes you get to rehearse, but very, very rarely. There's a spontaneity, and you're right, you have to think very fast on your feet, and you get sharp, your imagination flies, and you see something, a prop, or a piece of scenery, or a costume, or something another actor will do, or something yourself will do, which will spark something. So all of that makes it more...
It just kind of flows out of you, doesn't it?
It does.
You like to talk, you like to...
I do. I've been talking for a long time today.
But you're not slowing down, it doesn't look like.
You know, I really love this movie, and the feedback on this movie has been so positive.
Were you there at the screening?
No, I wasn't last night, but I hear I saw it in L.A. and it was equally as enthusiastic. Mm-hmm. So that, you as an actor, when you get that response, makes you feel so good. You know, you want to talk about it. You know, there's so many movies that you make that aren't successful and people go, oh, well, you know. It's so great to have something that people like.
Was there a time when you felt the same about Turk 182? I thought maybe that was going to go a little further than it did.
I think that the germ of the idea of Turk 182 was fascinating, about this young kid sort of underground spray painting New York City. I mean, it could have been great, but it took a turn in a different direction, and I think that the time that it came out was not a good time. The studio was changing hands, and it sort of got lost in the shuffle.
And in the meantime, isn't it nice to be using your own green eyes for this interview?
Oh, God, I tell you. The last time I took him out, I put him down and stepped on him.
The hazards of movie making with Kim Cattrall and Big Trouble in Little China, and I'm John Tibbetts.